how do supermassive black holes exist? Our Milky Way galaxy looks the way that it does, in part because it's driven by what's happening at this black hole at the very center. But how this process actually works, how matter flowing into the black hole, growing the black hole, releases all of this energy and affects the galaxy at large, is still an open puzzle, and that's what we're trying to figure out. Matter is funneling in towards the black hole, rotating around the black hole, and eventually that matter forms into what we call an accretion disk. It's a very dense environment. Gas gets hot just due to friction, and it gets so hot that it radiates light. And that's how these black holes can actually be the most luminous objects in the universe. So in supermassive black holes, that accretion disk, that inflow of matter, produces radiation in the ultraviolet band. But what we see in all supermassive black holes is an enormous amount of X-ray emission. What we still don't really understand is where do these X-rays come from at all? The inflow of matter through this accretion disk that creates this thermal radiation, that disk doesn't get hot enough to produce X-rays. And so instead, there must be this other, even hotter, plasma around the black hole. We call this plasma the corona. So whereas the accretion disk itself is maybe about 1,000,000 degrees Kelvin, this other hot plasma is about 1,000,000,000 degrees. In order to understand this process, you really need to zoom into the innermost regions. The problem is these regions around the black hole, the event horizon scales, are incredibly small, and they are very hard to spatially resolve with our telescopes. In the past several years, we've really had a revolution in this field, thanks to the launch of the NICER Observatory. This is a telescope that's really just about the size of a washing machine, and it sits on the International Space Station. What NICER has is amazing temporal resolution. It's able to collect a lot of photons and time tag those photons extremely precisely. The technique that we have pioneered is called reverberation mapping. And what we're doing with reverberation mapping, it's really kind of swapping spatial resolution for time resolution. So similar to how bats use echolocation, they make sounds and they wait for those echoes to reflect back to map out a dark cave that they can't see directly, we're measuring echoes of light around the black hole. And then we take those echoes and reconstruct an image of the black hole. This corona around black holes is producing a lot of X-ray emission, and we see some of those X-ray photons from the corona directly at our telescopes, but some of those X-ray photons will irradiate the accretion disk and cause that accretion disk to fluoresce. And so what we're measuring with this X-ray echo technique is the direct emission from the corona, and then the X-ray photons that have taken the extra light path to the disk reflected off of the disk, and we see that emission delayed. Then we can use that time delay to infer the distance that light has traveled from the corona to the accretion disk, and that's essentially how we map out these disks and reconstruct an image. With that time resolution, we've really been able to expand reverberation mapping not just to supermassive black holes sitting at the centers of all galaxies, but also to stellar mass black holes in our own galaxy. These stellar mass black holes are just like little miniature versions of the supermassive black holes. They're so much closer, and so they're a lot brighter. We've really had a breakthrough in the past 5 years. Essentially, we were able to measure the spin of the black hole. So this was an important advancement in measuring fundamental properties of black holes. My graduate student, Jingyi Wang, she was able to discover a connection between the geometry of this corona that's really close to the event horizon of the black hole and these relativistic jets that we see both in stellar mass black holes, but also in supermassive black holes. And these relativistic jets of particles moving at close to the speed of light, they can extend to galactic scales. And so what it looks like is that this corona may be the launching point, the acceleration region of this relativistic jet, which is fundamental for understanding, you know, how do black holes affect their large-scale environments. I worked with some collaborators at MIT in music and anthropology. We collaborated on turning simulations of light echoes around black holes into these sound echoes. Black holes sound eerie. You can really hear these relativistic effects, you know, the warping of space and time, the stretching of the wavelength of light. The most exciting part is that we need Einstein's general relativity to really explain the observations that we're seeing, and that really means that we are looking close to the event horizon of the black hole.